Okay, video two of area properties for mechanics two. We are going to talk today about the moments of inertia of built girders. This is another example of a built girder. We have two channels here, back to back, and they are joined by these plates. And by positioning these two channels or these sections like this, we are getting a very good section for a girder, or trabe in Spanish. Okay, in Mexican Spanish is trabe or beam, viga. Okay, usually they are built in the workshop for specific applications, and sometimes we need to find the properties. For this, you can draw this in a different application. There are some one called section, and I think it's available in Android. I haven't found one for iOS, but you will see the procedure here. You can do it in any hoja de cálculo spreadsheet that you may have, and it's going to be a very simple procedure. And once you have it well, you can calculate it for any built girder. What is the inertia? And for this, probably I will stop the presentation for a second. Let me get, I have a model of a beam. Just let me find it because the lady is here. That cleans my bedroom, takes it. Now, I'm going to stop the presentation for a second and we come back and I have my model. Can you see this beam? The cross section is what you see in red, okay? Now, this was made with three different plates of wood, vertical one and two horizontal ones. Yeah, you see that? And I can place it like this between two supports and it becomes a beam. And I put loads on top here, okay? We can have my assistant sitting there and it's a load and I have the beam, okay? And it might produce, if this assistant was too heavy, this thing will deform, okay? Producing like an arc here behind, below the beam. This is called flexure, it's called bending, okay? Now, there are two possibilities, that I place the beam like this or that I place it like this. Obviously, by common sense, probably by experience, we might know that this is a better position than placing it like this, okay? This is very evident if we have only one piece. For instance, the ruler, the plastic ruler that you use in primary school, that you were always breaking because you were playing like swords, it could bend in one direction, but in the other one, in the vertical, it was not easy to bend it. Okay, let me see if I find something here to show you. I have this medicine box. For instance, I could apply bending and deform it like this, and you see a curve like here. But if I put it vertical, this is the same cross section, rectangle, I cannot bend it. You see, it tries to break. So there's a weak axis in the cross section that is allowing me to bend it compared to the other one that is stronger, okay? That's what we are, this property that is stopping me from deforming it is a property of the cross section and it is called inertia moment, of moment of inertia, second area moment. And it's a very, very important property, probably the most important property that you need to know of cross sections for this course. That is mechanics two, in which we deal with beams and columns. Okay, so now let me put you another example. Imagine this is a tower, a building, a skyscraper, and you build like this, like the United Nations buildings, building in New York, okay? And now that the movie Godzilla and Kong are going to appear, what is easier if my assistant was Godzilla and was trying to push it. To top it over like this, or like this on the other sense. So we call it this number one in this sense, and number two in the other sense, which is easier. If this is a building and this is Godzilla. Number one. Why Godzilla can do it in number one easier than this one? The answer is because there are two different moments of inertia of the cross section, the rectangular cross section. One is trying to bend it with respect to a weaker axis that in this case is going to be, well, this thing is not marking, let me see. But my pulse is like if I had 10 cups of coffee, this axis, you cannot see the line. So axis like this, when the Godzilla arrives and pushes it, and I place my right hand, I put the thumb along the axis, and this is the effect of, so this is the axis that is opposing this rotation. Whereas if I go in the other sense, like this, my thumb is on the other axis, you see? In this case, for instance, the X axis, and it is going to be stronger or difficult, more difficult to be top over, okay? This is the strong axis then. And when I do it like this, it's easier because the axis is the vertical one, the Y. We are going to see that now in the presentation. Okay, so now we have learned with the assistant that there are two different axes. Now, if I tell you what is the strong axis in this cross section, if I let me annotate here, for instance, draw. Okay, this is the X axis. And this is going to be the Y axis. Now, imagine that you are able to lift this cross section and place it like a tower. Which is the strong axis and which is the weak axis in this one?
The strong is Y?
No. If you put it vertical and Godzilla arrives in this sense, it's going to try to top it over around the Y axis. So Y axis is weak. Okay. Whereas if Godzilla arrives, and this is a tower, in this sense, Godzilla arrives from this side, is going to try to top it over or around this axis, and it's going to be more difficult than if he arrives on this side, okay? This is the equivalent to my box of medicine that was a rectangle like this, okay? It was easier when Godzilla was arriving on this side with respect to the weak axis Y. But when Godzilla was arriving in this sense, it was trying to top it over around X, it was more difficult, okay? So all cross sections, they have one axis that is weaker than the other one if they are not double symmetry in the section. If there is double symmetry in the section, then the inertia moment is the same. For instance, if this was a square, okay? If it was a square, we have the two axes being the same, and then no weak axis, no strong axis. They both are the same. The property, the inertia moment of the section with respect to X will be the same as with Y, but that's not the case for non-symmetric sections, okay? That's why we need to calculate the two. I recommend you again the application on the telephone, if you have Android, called Section Properties. Let me show it to you how it looks like on the telephone. if I find it. It's called steel sections. I don't know if you find it. It's the bottom one there. Can you see it? Steel sections. Okay. If you open it, it gives you a menu. And you have user section. You go to user section and you can choose from a different kind of shapes. You put the dimensions and it calculates for you these inertia moments and the centroid and whatever. But we need to learn how to do it by hand. And that's what we're going to learn today in this short video. Okay. So we were dealing with this section in the previous video and we found the centroid at that position. We already know these are the coordinates of the global centroid. This is the first step for this procedure now is to find the centroid. I'm using the same example as in the previous video. That's why I don't go over to find the centroid. But that's the first step of this procedure. Now, we are going to find the inertia moment with respect to this centroidal axis XX uppercase to differentiate it from the local axis of each figure. This is the global centroid, okay? And we found it in the previous video. Now, we need to find a distance from each of these centroids to the global one. How we do that? I have a formula for you, this one here, this formula. We know the coordinate Y bar is 142. We just need to subtract the value of the coordinate of each centroid with respect to the origin. We already had that column, this column, in the previous step of calculating the centroid. This was the coordinate in Y of each figure of their own centroid. So we do this. Y bar 142.41 minus 1250, I get this. Okay. This is Y bar 142. To this value, I'm going to subtract this value and I get this. Again, to this value, I'm going to subtract this value and I get this. Look, now it's negative. Now to this value, I subtract this value and it's also negative. These are the distances from this centroid to the global one. This is the distance from this centroid to this one. And this is the distance from the third centroid to the global one. Why is it negative? Because we have indicated that everything going down was positive. And from this centroid, we need to go up against this. That's why it's negative. From this one, we need to go up to get to the global centroid. Please analyze the table. And if you have any questions, ask them now. Okay? Feel free. This is one of the most important steps. Is it clear? I'm going to play crickets.
Yes, it's clear.
Okay. Can we continue to the next step?
Yes.
Well, this is just the explanation for each one of them. I already did why it is negative, why the other one is positive. Now, this looks like horrible, like a formula from hell. But in fact, it's a very simple formula. We are going to use the letter I, uppercase I, to refer to the inertia moment. Now we have only rectangles, okay? The inertia is again an integral, and you can go to any book of statics and find the formula with integrals. And there are some professors in engineering, like the ones who taught me, who like to draw, not have this kind of figure, but they will draw you something like this, like a cross section like this. And then you need to find, using the integrals, the inertia moment. But to be honest, when on earth are we going to have a beam like this? We always have in the built environment these kind of beams. You agree? Made with plates, steel plates, regular shapes. And for regular shapes, there are already formulas at the back of each of the statics book that tell you what are the inertia for a rectangle. This step is not included here, but I'm going to draw it. Let me draw it. And let's imagine I have a rectangle like this, okay? What is the inertia for, let me draw this axis. Let's change the color. It will have, this is the XX of the rectangle, more or less, you agree? And this is the YY, you agree?
Yes.
Okay. Let me put a Y here just to indicate this is Y. And let me put an X here to indicate this is the X of the rectangle, okay? Now, we call this B, the base of the rectangle, and the height, we call it H. Okay, the full distance from here to here, that's H, and this is B. You know that from primary school, base por altura, el área. You agree? We just need to remember now what are the formulas. We need this. This formula, the first one, IXI. This I, this letter I, indicates the index. Which figure are we dealing with? Number one, and then wherever we see I is one and one. Okay, so don't get worried about this. So this term here, let me draw it. This one here, the IXY, what is it? I'm going to put it here in text. IX for a rectangle is equal to 1 divided by 12, sorry, V times H, but H is elevated to the third power, H cubic. That's the value of IH, this one, that we need in the formula. So for each rectangle, I need to calculate this. In the previous table, I already have a table with B and H for each figure. So I just need to calculate it here. And this is here in this column, 390,625 after I do this operation. Using what? The bay, the base for figure one and the height for figure one. It's not included here, but it's in the same table before calculating the area, okay? Now I do the same for figure two and the same for figure three. And you see they are all different. Now, this is the inertia for each rectangle, individual rectangle. This is the inertia with respect to X, for this X, for this X, and for this X of the third rectangle. If I add them together, if the question is, what is the total inertia of the shape? Well, somebody could say, well, just add together all the inertias, this column, and I get this, 56,754,941.7 units. In this case, it's millimeters. What is the unit of the inertia? Is units of length to the fourth, okay? Millimeters to the fourth, inches to the fourth, meters to the fourth, whatever, centimeters to the fourth. Centímetros cuartos, metros cuartos, milímetros cuartos, pulgadas cuartas. Those are the units of the inertia. And this will be, if my question is, what is the total inertia of this cross section in red? Somebody will say, well, I calculate the one of this rectangle, the one of this rectangle, and the one of this rectangle, and add them together with respect to X. We are, remember, we are dealing first with the X axis of the global figure. But I will be wrong. That's not the correct answer. Just add them together, these values. There's something called the parallel axis theorem, teorema de ejes paralelos, that indicates that we need to add something else. The position of this area with respect to the global axis has an effect on the inertia, okay? And that effect is calculated using this formula. The area of the individual figure times the distance that we just calculated in the previous slide to the square distance, that distance to the power of 2. And you see the units, area is got units of length to the squares, metros cuadrados, centímetros cuadrados, pulgadas cuadradas, lo que sea, millimeters to the square millimeters here, times square millimeters, you give us millimeters to the fourth, okay? The same units as this one. But we need to add this term. And when we do this calculation, we already have the area here for each figure. Sorry about that. We have the area here for each figure times the distance squared. The distance was calculated in the previous slide like this. I elevate it to the square and I multiply it by the area and I get this. And compare this to this. The inertia of this figure one alone is 390,625. But the effect it has with the axis in the centroid is very big compared to the inertia in its own centroid. This contribution, that's why these kind of shapes, the I-beams, Las Vegas is, they are very, very efficient because we put material on the ends far away from the centroid and they contribute, they give a lot of inertia by the parallel axis theorem with this term. So by using this, we get an inertia. Look at this sum of all the terms, the similar terms here compared to this one. And the total one is indicated by the summation of this column plus this column. I get this. This will be the total inertia with respect to X of this figure, okay? And the most important part was the contribution of the areas that are far from the centroid. Look at the contribution here for the area number 2 is lower than the one of the sun centroid. This is quite big because it's a vertical rectangle. But the other areas contribute a lot because they are far from the centroid, okay? That's why these shapes are very efficient and they are used everywhere as beams and columns because it gives a big inertia and we are not using material here. Compared to our full rectangle, if this was a full rectangle, we will use much more material and the inertia will not be very far from the inertia of this, okay? Having the material at the ends, okay? Any questions? We calculated the X inertia. Now I will write here the inertia for the other axis, the vertical one. We call it the IY. And it's again 1/12 of HV to the cubic. Sorry. You see that we just invert these two. Okay. Obviously, if H is greater than B, the axis X is going to be the strong axis because H is going to be here to the cubic. And this one is going to be lower when H is bigger than B. You agree? Any questions? I already lost you. Houston, we have a problem. That's why I have this background now, because we are far from Earth. This is the moon. And we are like in Apollo 13. Houston, we have a problem. Any questions? Is it clear? Crystal clear?
It's clear.
Yeah. Okay. Let's go to the next one. Let me remove, erase what is not needed in the next one. Okay. Sorry. Now, for the YY, we can see something. All the centroids are on top of the axis, the global axis. Here, this is the second centroid, is lying on top of the axis, and the same for the third one. What is going to happen now? There's going to be an effect on what? On the parallel axis theorem. Because the distances, the coordinates of the centroids were all like this, 150. And the same coordinates for the global centroid. When I do this operation, the distance is zero. Okay? Because they have the same coordinate, this 150 minus 150 equals zero. 150 minus 150, zero, and so on. So what happens? When I calculate this term, they are all zero because the distance is zero. Sorry, here is dx, okay? There's a mistake or typo there. Just copy paste sometimes makes you, I'm going to, and this is A times dx square, okay? This one. Well, this is zero because the areas are not, their centroids are located on top of the y-axis. That means that the inertia is only going to be the sum of this, and it's 69 million. Compared to what for the x-axis? We had what for the x? We had 331 million compared to 69 million. Now you can see with numbers, which is the strong axis for this figure? Which one is it?
The X.
Yes, the X, because we have here this result, a summary, okay? I don't know if you can hear my dog snoring, but he's having a good time. And he's using the baby Yoda as pillow. Sorry about the snoring. So, any questions?
No.
This is the procedure to calculate the inertias. There are two inertias in every section, okay? We will have one for X and one for Y. And if the figure is not a square, then there will be a difference in these two values. And that will lead to a strong axis and a weak axis, okay? Okay, let me see what's next here. As conclusion, you can see several shapes here made in the workshop. Look at this one, this looks like a star, okay? It's a cross. It's also a build section, a build girder. This is another one, plate. This is another one, look how they are preparing it. the procedure will be the same. Now, what are the applications of this? Well, imagine you get a job in a steel producer or in a construction company that is making steel structures. And sometimes they optimize their designs and not use commercial profiles. They have to use different things preparing the workshop like this one. So you will have to have a way to calculate the inertias in order to give this number to the software that is going to do the structural analysis. Okay, this is a property that we will always use and is very, very, very important. Depending on that number of inertias, it will be the deformation that we will see in beams under loads, what we call deflections. Okay, so that's why we learn to do it by hand, but not to using integrals, but using something that is common in practice. We could have double T. What are double T? Well, imagine that we remove the bottom plate here, and it will be just this and these two verticals. That will be a double T. A T beam, an I beam, or something called cajon. If you produce a rectangle or a trapezoid with four plates, then you get a section that is called a cajon or a box girder. Well, that's it. That's the procedure to calculate inertias of built girders. I'm going to stop the video and I will be opening, or you have any question, please tell me and I go back to any slide you want. I leave it in the summary. Questions?
No.
Is it clear? I have the same in Spanish. You can check your syllables and the playlist that is suggested includes three videos. The third one, let me show it to you. Let me stop sharing. And I will show it to you. You can go to my YouTube channel. Just let me open it here. And I gave you a list that it says centroids and inertias. Let me see. One second. Just a second. It's amazing. I cannot find things in my own channel. Well, we can just open the syllabus. I will do that. And then we go to this course. And I will open the playlist that I recommended you. To show you the third video that I was telling you that I will not. In fact, it's like four videos, not three. Now you can see it, isn't it? You are seeing the playlist. These ones are the two videos we saw today. I mean, but in English. These are in Spanish there. This is like a summary. I recommend you to watch it. And then this one, I talk especially about weak axis and strong axis and the importance of the inertia moment. So I recommend you, all these four videos are in Spanish, but probably you can put there subtitles and you have basic Spanish for people following me, not you, of course, you know Spanish, my students here in Mexico. But the ones abroad, they can follow this extra material for this topic. Okay. Now let me stop recording. The end of video number two.